Hello, I'm Haslinda. I'm in Singapore. If a picture paints 1,000 words, then Steve McCurry's work is limitless. He's the man who shot the Afghan Girl, a world-famous photographer who focuses on conflict and culture. The master photographer, Steve McCurry, is today's high flyer. Born in Philadelphia, a child of the 50s, Steve's life through the lens has captured some of the world's most iconic moments. From the time he stepped across the border into Afghanistan before the Russian invasion, to his famous work, The Afghan Girl, a portrait of a preteen, her life frozen in time. From Beirut to the Gulf, Steve McCurry has seen the worst of what the world has to offer. And he was there too when the Twin Towers came down. But with the struggle comes resilience, and he captures that too, turning photography into art through the faces of history. Steve McCurry, welcome to High Flyers. It is a pleasure to have you with us today.
Great to be here.
Now, you took up photography seriously because you wanted to see the world. You left a job at a local publication because it was beginning to be boring. You bought a one-way ticket to India and never looked back.
I needed a job. I needed a way to kind of get moving in photography. So I ended up working for a very small suburban newspaper. And the assignments were not great. There was no way to really advance in this newspaper. So I just decided that I just had to take drastic measures, and I quit, got that ticket to India. I wanted to travel.
You were in your early 20s.
Yeah, I was in my early 20s. And I thought, you know what, I got to go for this. If I don't do it now, I'm just never going to happen. So I quit the job. Got the ticket to India.
Why India?
I picked India because when I was 19, I lived in Europe for a year. And then while I was in college, I went to Africa just as a tourist for a month or two. And another year in college, I went to Latin America. So when it came time to, like, well, where do I start? I wanted to go someplace new. And at that time, 1978, Soviet Union was not easy to travel in. China was not that easy, but India was open and fascinating, incredible culture.
At what point did you know that it was more than just a passion, that there was something big?
I think that as I was traveling around India and Nepal, I decided that this was really what I wanted to do sort of for the rest of my life, if I could make it work kind of economically, because you need money to live. But it was once I went into Afghanistan, once I started to be able to start to actually place those pictures I was making in major publications, then I thought, okay, now it's actually happening. I can actually work, make some money, and actually pay my way in the world.
And the validation came because, you know, you received a lot of awards. You were the first recipient for the Leica Hall of Fame. You were Magazine Photographer of the Year. But the life-changing, perhaps, was the Robert Capa Award for you.
Yeah, the Robert Capa Award was the first award as a kind of in my career. And it's a very prestigious award. And I felt it was kind of like an out-of-body experience, you know, why they chose me. But I was very honored and humbled, and I thought, you know, now I can really see that I can make a go of this profession.
You're a master photographer, one of few master photographers in the world. You know, when you talk about photography, is it innate? I mean, must you have that something special to produce, that something special, or can you be trained for it?
Well, I think you can learn a lot. I think you can go a certain distance with just learning lighting and composition, but there's this kind of component of talent. that kicks in. And there's no guarantee of how much talent we have. You know, you there's some people like geniuses, like, say, Picasso or Rembrandt. But for the rest of us mere mortals, you know, you just, you know, you don't really know how much talent you have. So I was willing to work really hard every day. And it was sort of like became like just a way of life where you never really disconnect. You're always kind of plugged into the. And but I thought, you know what, I got to, there's no, I've come this far, I can't turn back. I have to go full speed ahead.
Talking about documenting, Kodak gave you the last roll of film. How did that feel? It was a momentous occasion.
Well, you know, I had been using Kodachrome film, and I, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of pictures on Kodachrome. And then when they said that they were going to discontinue, it was like a shock. It was like a friend was dying, and you know, and I thought it occurred to me that I want to get that last roll of Kodachrome and pay some kind of homage or some kind of a record, some kind of a statement about this film. So Kodak gave me the film, and I said, okay, what can I do with this film that's going to be iconic? I live in New York. Who's in New York that's iconic? So I thought, you know, Robert De Niro was a very important New Yorker. And I thought, well, you know, India's been so important to me in my career. Let me take this role and go to India and photograph some personalities. And so I went to a tribe whose way of life was disappearing. They were nomadic, and so I photographed them. And I just went around just photographing random things that I thought were important to me in my life, and that was the project. As soon as I walked in, I noticed this one girl kind of in the corner with these incredible eyes and this really intense kind of expression, this look. And instantly I knew that this was what I wanted to photograph.
Now, Steve, 40 years of photography, you spent so much time as well in the war zones. Why the war zones? Why Afghanistan? Why Iraq? What's the fascination, perhaps?
I think when you're young and foolish, I think you're looking for a great story to tell. I think you're looking for adventure. I think you want to make a mark. Plus, you're looking for work, you know? And going to a place like Afghanistan, this was an incredible, important, kind of almost a historic moment. You had these two sides locked in kind of a death struggle, people fighting for their way of life, and to go there and document, to record that, it was kind of a historical moment, being on the front row of history in a way.
People talk about being at the right place at the right time, and you were at the right place at the right time in a way. Luck, to an extent, had a role in it. It was when the Russians invaded Afghanistan, and you were there to witness it, and your stories were needed.
Yeah, it was. I had already spent about 2 years in India, just wandering around looking for stories and getting to know the country. And just by, I don't know, coincidence, I went into Pakistan, up in the mountains, and I met two refugees, Afghan refugees, that were staying in my hotel, and they said, yeah, you're a photographer. This war is raging over the next, mountain range. We want you to come in. We want to take you in and show you what's happening so you can tell the world what's going on. So I went in, and then I got hooked on the story because I started, you know, seeing, becoming friendly with them, was staying in their homes. And I started understanding the story because a lot of the villages had been bombed. I started seeing firsthand what was going on. So I was there for a couple of weeks, took the film, sent it back to my sister, actually. And then I decided to go back again And then I went back again and again, and it ended up going there 30 times.
And you were dressed as an Afghani, and to my understanding that you also, capped your film in your turban.
Well, I was worried when I went, because I went in across the border without a passport, with kind of almost illegally. I thought if I get stopped and they ask me, you know, who are you and why haven't you gone into the proper channels, and they searched me, I thought, well, I better hide my exposed film. So I actually put it into, like sewed it into my garments. And then the film that wasn't exposed, I had that in my camera bag, and I was ready to give them that film and keep the film. So I was worried after I had risked my life for that film.
How challenging, how emotional is it to be a photographer witnessing the violence, the pain? Did you find buffer in your lens?
I think in a way you can kind of hide behind your lens because that's the reason you're there. And when you're looking through the lens, you're a little bit detached. You can look at sometimes terrible things and kind of frame it without in some ways really looking at it. Ultimately, you want to tell that story because we all want the world to be a better place. And when terrible things are happening, we want to shed light on those things so that something can happen to make a good resolution of the problem.
You have 800,000 transparencies in your archive, and I believe even more, perhaps.
Maybe close to a million.
Are there favorite photos that you've taken that you remember and that you're really proud of?
You know, when you go out and work, every picture isn't that good, and sometimes you spend a day and you only get one or two good pictures. But I have some that I treasure, some that I think are important, some I think have historic value, artistic value.
Would it include the Afghan girl with the piercing green eyes? I mean, that's iconic. The world knows that photo.
Yeah, that would be in my top 10 for sure.
Tell us the story behind that photo.
This was a time when there were maybe 2 million Afghan refugees living in Pakistan or along the border. This was a huge kind of international story, a problem. The Russians, the Soviet Union, were bombing villages. I wanted to kind of explore some of this region. And one morning I happened to be in a refugee camp and I was almost ready to leave. And I heard these young girls in a tent, which turned out to be a school. So I went in and I asked the teacher if I could, I had a permission and all that. I went in and I asked her if I could photograph her class. And so but as soon as I walked in, I noticed this one girl kind of in the corner with these incredible eyes and this really intense kind of expressionist look. And instantly I knew that this was what I wanted to photograph in this class. I mean, everything else kind of went away.
But you didn't think it was going to be so iconic.
Well, my mind was racing and kind of swirling around because I was trying to, again, photograph the class, but I was trying to figure a strategy to photograph her without her being maybe too shy. And, you know, so I was photographing the other students. I was photographing. And after a while, I think she started to maybe feel like she was being excluded. So then the teacher said, let this photographer take your picture. And so she sat in front of my lens, maybe a minute or two. I made a few pictures. I think part of her expression was curiosity about me, because I was a foreigner. I was dressed differently. I spoke a different language. I had this funny camera. But, you know, she had a very traumatic childhood. She was an orphan refugee living in this really kind of terrible camp. So she had a very difficult life, and I think that part of that trauma was, you know, you could see that in her face. So I went up on the roof of my apartment building and started photographing, and to all of our horror that the first tower collapsed. And then as the seconds went by, it was like, no, this is real. This isn't a dream.
Stephen, your 40 years of experience, you've seen a lot, including the fall of the Twin Towers in New York. I mean, you were one of the early ones to capture that incident. What was it like?
Yeah, I just returned from China the night before. I got back to New York on the evening of the 10th. And I was tired. I was jet lagged. Put my cameras off in the corner. And the next morning, I went down. I live very close to the World Trade Center. And I went out of my office, started opening up mail, and we got a phone call that the towers were on fire, both of them. So I looked out the window and I thought, oh my God, they're, you know. So I went up on the roof of my apartment building and started photographing. And to all of our horror, the first tower collapsed. And it was like, remember, I thought, this is impossible, that this is just an my brain couldn't process it. And then as the seconds went by, it was like, no, this is real. This isn't a dream. So then I kind of gathered myself together. And then I kind of went back on the other tower. And I was thinking, you know, because I was up there for about 20 minutes photographing. And I wanted to go down and photograph it from street level, right at the, and I was thinking to myself, as this tower collapsed, you know, I could have easily been down there photographing underneath the tower. And as I saw it collapsing, I realized how many thousands of people were being killed, either in the tower, in the towers, or surrounding, because it covered a vast area of ground. So then I thought, you know what? I'm a photographer. I have to document this. This is kind of what I do. So somebody needs to go down and record this. So I grabbed my cameras and went down with my assistant. And I literally spent the entire day photographing what was happening there, the rescue effort, and just this incredible pile of rubble, which had been one of the most important office buildings in our country.
Do such images haunt you?
Well, I think it's hard to, I didn't really look at that film for about 5 years after I made the pictures. I did a quick edit and I just put them in a drawer. I didn't even look at them because it was something which was so horrific and so disturbing. I didn't want to really have that memory. For weeks after the collapse of the towers, the smoke would come up into our apartment building. So I could actually smell that aftermath.
You speak of trauma. You were also there during the Gulf War, the first Gulf War. What was that like?
Well, you know, the ground war, I went in on the ground with the soldiers. I went in the first 3 days. What was so dramatic about that was that Saddam Hussein had lit about 600 oil wells on fire, so that the whole region was under this cloud of smoke, and all these oil wells were on fire. It really was like being on another planet, this dark, you know, even during the middle of the day, it was still like night, and then they had these geysers of fire shooting out of the ground. And then you had all this destruction from the war. There were dead bodies everywhere, and it sort of looked like a big, huge movie set, although it was real. So I was there for maybe a month, in kind of working in this area, and it was monumental. It was biblical. It was this epic view, the scene of destruction. It was like the end of the world.
I guess the question really is, how do you rise above the physical and emotional
challenge that you have to go through during these assignments?
Well, I think you put yourself into a certain mindset that, you know, I'm here to do a job. My job, I have to document. We have to remember these things to try, you know, not to repeat it. That was a terrible event, the Gulf War, and I think we can't forget these kind of things. So I think you have to convince yourself to kind of separate your emotions from your kind of your duty, because without, you know, people, you know, television crews and radio and newspaper, we wouldn't get that information. That's the way we get our information, is by people that actually go there and do the work.
Earlier we talked about how technology has changed photography. Everybody has a mobile phone. Everyone goes around taking photos. I mean, for you to see this change from film to digital, I mean, how do you feel about it?
Well, I'm a big fan of digital photography for two reasons. One is that you can see your pictures immediately, and you can decide, you can evaluate the composition, the light, the moment, and you can kind of see if you're getting what you're hoping to get. The other great thing, which is maybe even more important, is you can photograph in really low light. In film, you can never do that. You could maybe use a tripod or use a flash, but with digital, you can really shoot in almost, you know, total darkness, which is a big benefit, because I love dark, moody scenes on the street or in a cafe or in a, you know, some kind of a, you know, temple or whatever.
And the question of authenticity of photos also come in play. I mean, what's your take on that?
I think that there's so many different kinds of photography. There's sort of journalistic photography, there's fine art photography, there's advertising photography. So there's different ethics and rules that apply. I mean, with art, you basically do anything you want to. But I think with in journalism, I think what we want are facts. We want the truth. We want to know that the writer or the photographer, or we don't want their opinion. We don't want them to editorialize. Just show us what the place looks like. Whereas I think I think of myself more as a poet, and it's more of a personal expression. I want to tell my story. I want to go to a place and really discover it, and have my with my own curiosity to decide what about this place fascinates me personally.
Steve, before we let you go, just one final question. What's the one thing that people don't know about you?
I think the one thing people don't know about me now is that this old guy, this guy who should be, you know, sitting on his porch, you know, watching life go by, now has a three-year-old daughter who is enriching my life and making my life so much more fun to be able to play with her and hang out with her. It's the new something which I can't ever have imagined. I would end up being a dad at almost 70 years old.
Steve McCurry, thank you so much for being on High Fly. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much.